your blood that makes me clean. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Not ashamed of your love, not ashamed of your griefs, not ashamed of the cross, not ashamed.
Some days it was noise that he was in the house. Tell me, is Jesus in the house this morning?
Yes!
Chapter 2 goes on to say, when the people heard it, they gathered to hear him preach the word. There were so many people that nobody could approach him. Then came to him four men carrying a fifth man who was paralyzed and couldn't walk. When they saw that they would not be able to approach Jesus, they climbed to the roof of the house and began to remove the thatch. They literally tore the roof off the place. When they had a hole big enough, they lowered the paralyzed man down to Jesus, bed and all. Ladies and gentlemen, I want to be like those four men. I want to be a person who doesn't give up on my friends. Those four guys loved their friends so much that they would not let anything stand in the way of his coming to Jesus. In fact, they carried him to him. Oh, to be a friend like that. I aspire to be that kind of friend, that kind of man. Do you? When you know someone is in need, are you there to help? Or do you just say, I'll pray for you? And then leave it at that. Do you love in both word and deed? Our greatest example of what this looks like is the Lord Jesus himself. He loved us so much that he sacrificed himself for us. He didn't just say, I love you. He actually intervened in history. for each one of us. John 15, 13, greater love hath no man than this, that he lay down his life for his friend. That's the kind of friend the four in this morning's story were. That's the kind of friends I want. That's the kind of friend I want to be. I love and worship Jesus for being that kind of friend to me, to you. Let's pray. Father God, thank you for being here amongst us this morning. Thank you for your grace. Thank you for your coming to earth, intervening in history, and being a friend to each of us. Thank you for taking our sins upon yourself on that cross and paying the price for us. Lord, we worship you, and we praise you, and we thank you. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Amen. Thanks, Randy. Let's stand and sing.
I'll never amazed and overwhelmed at how your mercy fell and changed a heart as hard as mine. I tried to turn away, deny the hand you gave, but you
together as your community and the sheep of your pasture this morning. We thank you for the love that you have for us that we can share with each other. You are so great in our midst, God, and so we submit to you, we give to you. We trust that you will be glorified with all that we have. For it all comes from you anyway. And so take these gifts and tithes and offerings, Lord, wherever they come from, however we have earned it, it's from you. And so we give it back to you. For every breath that we take, Lord, comes from you. And so we will praise you with that breath. Accept these gifts now. Multiply them for your glory. Jesus' name.
Thank you.
His amazing grace.
Yes. For me, it was getting back into a church period. Before that, I had faith and I knew everything, but it wasn't complete. There was a major piece missing in my life, and it was the Holy Spirit. When I was coming for a month or so, Caitlin invited me to come along with Monday night prayer. I came, but the first several weeks I was very reserved and nervous. Then Larissa happened. Or more honestly, I should say, the Holy Spirit happened through Larissa. That night, my eyes were open to a power of God that I had been denying for years. I began to seek out the Holy Spirit instead of hiding from it. I wanted to discover its gifts and learn to lean on it for guidance. And all of that really just required one thing, and that was learning to listen. The Holy Spirit started whispering ideas of going to school probably about 6 months ago. Again, I tried to turn away and deny it. High school did not end well, and college was something that I never wanted to get into. But then the thoughts of school just kept coming. So finally I gave in and started looking into the application process. But my plan was only to do part-time. It could have started back in September, but at the time we were planning our wedding. I could have started in October, but that was the week we were on our honeymoon. And the next option in line was January, just a couple weeks ago. So I said, yeah, things will be calmed down by then. I can finally start and do part-time. So I got registered at Malone to do online and to go part-time. So my plan was to continue to work full-time and do school part-time, and it would have taken probably about 8 years. But you know what they say, if you want to make God laugh, tell him your plans. His plan was obviously for me to finish much quicker. His way of telling me that was for me to unexpectedly lose my job. Some of you may remember the last time we were up here, it was Caitlin's I said yes. About the clear sign she got to continue to minister at the children's home. And at the time, I thought that her sign was confirmation of my sign. Well, it wasn't. At December 5th, they told me it was time to say goodbye. Came to the church that night to meet with Pastor Jim, told him the story and asked to be prayed over. And basically what he told me was, well, maybe this is just God's way of freeing you from a distraction so you can hit school and hit it hard. And then we prayed and talked about it and had others pray for us, and that's the conclusion we came to. So I upped my classes to full-time. Now, this didn't make Caitlin easy because we're newly married and now on one income and racking up school debt. But through prayer and discussion, she finally came around, and as we learned recently, she dipped her toes in the water and let God do the heavy lifting. I'm pleased to say that her faith has been rewarded. She starts a new job this week with better pay, better hours, and only about a third of the drive. As for me, my first couple weeks of school are done. It's going very, very well. And as parents recently taught us, the things we're doing now are to prepare us for the things we'll be called to in the future. So I'm pretty excited to see after school what I'm to say yes to next. Thank you.
Speak through Pastor Jim now. Let there be less of him and more of you. Let your word come forth with power, Lord. We thank you in Jesus' name. Amen. Oh, children are dismissed for children's church downstairs. Age 3 to grade 3.
Yep. Children are leaving and they're preparing for downstairs. I'd like to encourage the rest of you, if you would, to turn to Mark chapter 2. Mark chapter 2. So part of the deal is that, like, we understand, right, that ultimately God is the one that's driving us. That the Holy Spirit, as James shared, that Holy Spirit was there, he just hadn't really given credibility or permission for the Spirit of God to do what the Spirit of God wanted to do. And then he mentioned Larissa, and he said, then came Larissa, and more honestly, then came the Holy Spirit, something to that effect. There are people who have spoken into my life that God has kind of used like a brick on the accelerator, right? Like, Larissa's just one of those people, but there have been some others. You folks have known well that Rhoda's been one of those people for me, where God says, okay, I like the direction, but can we go somewhere now? God uses people to accelerate his business. This message is going to be a bit different today. It's a message where Jesus wants us to confidently believe in what he does as defined by him. This is a message where Jesus is going to challenge our beliefs. Do we believe Jesus? I guess it's an honest question. Do we believe Jesus? Do we believe his words? Do we believe his explanation for his actions and what the Bible tells us he did? Like, do we believe Jesus?
Yes.
Okay. So give me a definition then for believe. What does believe, how do you define believe?
It's an Anglo-Saxon word, and it means literally to live by.
To live by, okay? So that's how the Anglo-Saxons did it. How do we do it? What does it mean?
Faith and action.
Action.
Yeah.
Faith and action. So real quick, if you look back at Mark 1:15, Jesus said, the time is fulfilled. The kingdom of God is at hand. Repent, which means turn, to change. So repent. He says, and believe in the gospel, the good news. So if we're going to repent and turn, he's saying what you've been believing in, that's not how you're supposed to do it. You're going to have to repent and then turn and now believe in something different. Believe is one English word that is used for two Greek words, and usually it's the other way around, right? Because the Greek words are so profound that we oftentimes need more English words to actually understand what they're saying. But the first word means a fixed position. It's a Greek word that means a fixed position. And it's connected, ironically, to a Hebrew word that means under the thigh. Kent, where are you at? What is the connection with under the thigh? You preached a message about this years ago. I think you got this.
It was agreement, like a covenant.
Yeah. It's the oath, right? It is so serious that Abraham, who was sending his servant to look for a wife for Isaac, tells his servant, come put your hand under my thigh, right? Like, it's personal, you're putting your hand under my thigh. Come put your hand under my thigh and promise me, make me this covenant, this oath. Go find the wife for Isaac that God has said is to be. So it's a fixed position. It is a posture. It is a fixed position to believe. The second word means to be persuaded. Place confidence in. Place trust. Reliance in. To entrust one's well-being. Together they suggest a firm, fixed position, a posture, of being persuaded to the point of placing your well-being, confidence, trust, reliance in Jesus Christ. So remember last week I said that Mark is more focused on what Jesus did than what he said. And that's completely true. And yet today, when we look at what Jesus did, we need to understand why Jesus did what he did in Mark 2. And what it means to believe in the good news of Jesus. That fixed position of being persuaded to the point of placing our full confidence, trust, and reliance in Jesus Christ. Now, in order to believe in Jesus, placing unprecedented trust and confidence in him, we will have to look through both a microscope as well as a telescope. Jesus himself tells us not only what he did, but why he did what he did, including where his authority came from, for him to do what he did. And last week I asked you to look for a repetitive word in Mark 1, and the word was immediately. You saw it over and over and over. Today there is another repetitive word in Mark 2, and the word is why. Like, this is like having the child among you that just keeps saying, why? 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 Why did you do that? Jesus was being true to himself, true to his Father, true to his purpose, and each time it caused someone, oftentimes the religious leaders, to ask, why? Why does he speak like that? Why does he eat with those people? Why don't his disciples fast? Why do your disciples do what's unlawful on the Sabbath? And Jesus answers the ground level questions, and then he gives the 10,000 foot perspective. He zooms in, then he zooms out. So we're going to start with the microscope and zoom in. And let Jesus answer the ground level why. Jesus, why did you do that? And he grins a little bit and says, I'm glad you asked. Here's the truth. At the heart of every why is the realization that what Jesus was doing and teaching did not fit what they already believed. Their fixed position of what they were persuaded to trust. If they already believed what Jesus was doing and teaching, they would not have asked him why. They would have just said amen. Why do you do it? No, that's a statement that they are not there yet. So look at Mark 2, 1 to 12. I'm actually going to paraphrase most of these passages. But I'd like you to look down through this passage. Very familiar. We're told Jesus returned to Capernaum. It was reported he was there, went into the house. There were so many people that came, they couldn't get people through the door. And then it says, and they came bringing to him a paralytic carried by four men. And when they could not get near him because of the crowd, they literally ripped the roof off. When they made an opening, they let him down on a bed on which the paralytic lay. Jesus saw their faith. He said to the paralytic, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now some of the scribes were sitting there questioning in their hearts, "Why? Why does this man speak like that? He's blaspheming. Who can forgive sins but God alone?" And that's where you find this passage. There were at least four men who either believed or at least entertained the possibility that Jesus really could do what they had never seen. Just maybe. Like, we're willing to rip the roof off of this place, entertaining the possibility that what we believed all along isn't true. So they ripped the hole in the roof and let him down. But in 2:7, seriously religious people were offended. And they asked why Jesus would say, "Son, your sins are forgiven." Now keep in mind, he was not yet physically healed. "Son, your sins are forgiven." Jesus' answer? "Because I have that kind of authority." Why would you say that? "Because I can. And even though the greater miracle is to forgive sins, let me do something far less impressive, but easier for you to see and impossible for you to refute. Son, rise up, pack up, and go home." What's the greater miracle? Isn't it forgiveness of sin?
Come on.
And yet Jesus says, "But since you can't see that, since you can't see the redemption that just took place, let me show you something you can see." Jesus used the lesser to confirm the greater. I have told you guys probably ad nauseum. You could probably all go out and tell my story for me at this point. When a lady spoke truth over my life, prophetically spoke into my life, and she spoke deep personal things. And then she put her hand on my back and said, "How long have you had this pain?" And I haven't had the pain ever since. And most people keep coming back to, "What a miracle. You know the greater miracle? I forgave people that day." My dad routinely has taught that there are two things that you will never be able to do on your own. One is salvation, and the other is to forgive somebody else. And I'm telling you, the greatest miracle that I experienced that day was not my back, it was forgiveness that I offered. But every day I wake up and I don't feel the pain, I say, "Yes, you did that." What does belief look like here? Belief looks like that fixed position that says, "I am persuaded to trust that Jesus can heal the brokenness of sin and the brokenness of the body." Now zoom in on Mark 2, 13 to 17. Consider this story. Jesus went out again by the sea, and all the crowd was coming to him. He was teaching them, and as he passed by, he saw Levi, the son of Alphaeus, also known as Matthew, by the way. He looks at a tax collector, one of the scoundrels in their community. He says, "Follow me." And he rose up and followed him. He followed him right back. Matthew followed Jesus to Matthew's house, because that's where they go. And Jesus reclined a table in his house along with his friends, tax collectors, sinners. They're the ones that gathered. They felt at home. And the question is, why? Why does he eat with tax collectors and sinners? Now, there was at least one person in this section of verses who believed or entertained the possibility that Jesus really could do what they had never seen. He could redeem a sinner like me. So when Jesus spoke to Levi, to Matthew, and said, "Follow me," Matthew rose up, followed Jesus, and entertained Jesus along with many others who were deemed unredeemable. You know anybody that fits that quality? They are considered unredeemable. The model religious folks, again, have to ask why. They could not process what they were seeing. They didn't believe in this. Why are you, Jesus, recklessly hanging out with known sinners? Anyone with any self-respect knows it's best to hang out with people who are better at hiding their sins than this. Right? Because there really aren't sinless people. You ought to be hanging out with people who know the game and know how to keep from doing that. Jesus specifically tells them, as the great physician, I didn't come to coddle those who pretend to be healthy. I came to minister healing to those who can't hide their spiritually open wounds, their broken bones, and their hardened and congested spiritual hearts. I came for them. What does belief look like here? Belief is that fixed position that says, I am persuaded to trust that Jesus can cleanse and redeem even the most contemptible. He is that great physician. There is no wound or infection in a soul that Jesus can't heal. Which is why the Apostle Paul could look in the mirror and say, this Jesus came for the worst of sinners, of which it is me. Paul said, it's me. Now zoom in on Mark 2, 18 to 20. Because here there seems to be complete confusion. Now John's disciples and the Pharisees were fasting, and people came and said, why do John's disciples and the disciples of the Pharisees fast, but your disciples do not fast? And Jesus said to them, can the wedding guests fast while the bridegroom is with them? Sunday school class, we were talking about a wedding, right? As long as they have the bridegroom with them, they cannot fast. The days will come when the bridegroom is taken away from them, and they will fast in that day. In 2:18, it may seem that both John's disciples and the Pharisees came to ask Jesus why his disciples didn't fast as they did. It's also possible that there were simply other people who saw the fasting that was taking place. The language here is not completely clear. And they're asking Jesus, why do your disciples not do what the others seem to be doing? The point is, why is fasting important for them, but not for your disciples? And Jesus answered them in this parabolic language. Why would the wedding guest fast when the groom is with them? Trust me, that's not the time to fast. That's party time. They will fast. There is a place for fasting, Jesus says, but not when the I am is here. Jesus had to have a little smile on his face. There had to be this smirk when he said this. What does belief look like in these verses? This belief says that there is this time to fast, and there is a time to not fast. There is a time to feast. Is there a time to fast? Yes, but know when and why. And he's telling them, do not fast religiously. Fast strategically. Don't fast religiously.
Come on.
Fast strategically. Zoom in one more time. Mark 2, 23 to 28. Yes, I know, I just skipped a couple of really important verses. Because in 23 to 28, we're told how on a Sabbath, Jesus was going through the grain fields. As they made their way, his disciples began to pluck heads of grain, and the Pharisees were saying to him, look, they didn't talk to the disciples, by the way. They didn't say, why are you doing this? It says, look, why are they doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath? They're your disciples. You ought to straighten them out. This is your job. You fix them. The Pharisees have to ask why. Why are your disciples doing what is not lawful on the Sabbath? You know the Sabbath laws. The real question is, why don't you stop them? Why are you allowing them to do this? If you're also fired religious Jesus, then why are you letting this happen? And at this point, Jesus almost seems exasperated with their inability to believe, and he says, have you never read? You have the same scripture I'm looking at. Have you never read? They had come to believe that man was made for the Sabbath. Jesus said the Sabbath was made for man. We, people, we need to understand we benefit from physical rest and a spiritual refreshing. We prepare for God's visitation. That's what the Sabbath is about. The Son of Man, Jesus, is Lord of the Sabbath, not you. R.C.H. Lenski, a commentator, says that the Sabbath, given to Israel by God, was part of the preparation to fit Israel for its coming Savior. It was given to Israel by God, and it was part of the preparation to fit Israel for the coming Savior. These religious people had become worshipers of Sabbath rules instead of worshipers of the one who rules the Sabbath. What do you worship? The Sabbath rules, or the one who rules the Sabbath?
Come on. Wow.
Pam and I lived in Northwest Ohio 35 years ago. Something like that. And I'll never forget going in. I went to lunch at a restaurant in the bottom of a house. It's called Luganville's Restaurant. And it was for people who were farmers and shop workers. Like, you didn't have a blue collar or a dirty collar, you weren't allowed in. But there was a guy on Monday that when he walked down the steps, people saw his shoes coming down into the restroom. And he started to get catcalls, like, immediately. Because people were looking at him and saying, "Yeah, we saw where you were yesterday." Yesterday being Sunday. It had rained for so many days continuously, he couldn't get in his field. And finally, when he finally decided he could get his tractor through a portion of his field, which he couldn't get through for at least 3 weeks, and it was planting time, Sunday evening around 4 o'clock, he finally fired up a tractor and said, "I've got to do it." And instead of people saying, "Man, that's really rough. You haven't been able to get in the field." Instead of that, what's he get? Constant grief the entire time he was there until he finally left in a huff. We need to understand that we are not to become worshipers of Sabbath rules, but we are to worship the one who rules the Sabbath. What does belief look like here? Sabbath is not about legislation, it's about visitation.
Wow.
Sabbath is about the visitation of God. Now, I tell you what, I told Pam the other day, even if I went to a church that I thought was cold, dead, and lifeless, I can't imagine not showing up on Sunday morning. I just can't. I don't know. Like, I would keep going even if it felt empty, I think, because it seems to me that while I'm not a worshiper of Sabbath rules, just having the expectation that maybe today, when we gather together, when two or three gather together in His name, He's there with us. Like, maybe today we'll experience a visitation from God. Now you need to get to break out the telescope, because it's time to zoom out and go back to Mark 2, 21 and 22. "No one sews a piece of unshrunk cloth on an old garment. If he does, the patch tears away from it. The new from the old, and a worse tear is made. And no one puts new wine into an old wineskin. If he does, the wine will burst the skins, and the wine is destroyed, and so are the skins. But new wine is for fresh wineskins." This is setting right in the middle of this series of questions about why. This is not just dropped in as if it doesn't make sense. This is the big picture why. Jesus used illustrations that were true, undisputed, and well trusted. No one who understands cotton cloth would ever make a patch from a new, unshrunk piece of cloth and sew it on the old, torn, already shrunk cloth. So take your oldest favorite jeans that you've worn a hole in and try to patch them by cutting a patch from brand new jean material. Sew it on. Throw it in the wash and put the dryer on high. See what happens. Trust me. it will not go well. And some of you are saying, who would ever cut up the new material and put a patch on the old? I have pictures. I have pictures of what Pam used to do for me when I was working construction, especially roofing, and I would wear holes. And she would take old jean material and cut out the holes and put good reinforced jean material. Because I always wore them out here. I never wore out the back of my jeans, but once they were really, if they went twice, then she would take those, like, you aren't doing this to me again, right? I actually used to, I know a lady long since passed away that actually did her laundry and hung it out to dry. This is the truth. She patched her husband's underwear. And all of us knew it, we just couldn't say anything. In the same way, those that processed and packaged wine in their day knew how foolish it would be to take new wine, which they highly valued, and put it into an old used wineskin. Again, this is just fact. A lot can be said regarding this rich new wine and wineskin analogy. But in this context, I'd like for us to stay focused on this zoomed out 10,000 foot view. Jesus is making a point related to all of their wives. They all knew that an old wineskin would lose its ability to stretch and flex. It was because of the fermentation process that new wine had to be put into new wineskins, freshly produced animal skins that were not rigid. And they would not risk valuable wine by skimping on the packaging. That's what the wineskin was. It was packaging. But the cloth and the wine were just illustrations for something far more important. They were object lessons. Jesus did not use these illustrations so people would go home and tell their neighbors what they learned that day about cloth and wine. This is the 10,000 foot view that applied to each and every why that Jesus was asked throughout his ministry. Jesus used these undisputed truths to challenge them to consider how his new teaching with authority was not compatible with the teaching and authority that they were familiar with. And I would argue this is still true today. Keep in mind that since the main thing is the plain thing and the plain thing is the main thing, the primary message Jesus was teaching them was that his teaching, his authority, was superior to what they already had. They believed in their old perspective, and Jesus was saying, this is not compatible. It was impossible to take the authority of Jesus' teaching and power and reduce it so it could blend with what they already had. Somebody might get offended with that. It's still fact, folks. Like aged cloth or new wine, what Jesus delivers is not only incapable of coexisting or blending with what we already have without Jesus, we will completely destroy what it is that we value. That's true if we value the old. It's true if we value the new. When you try to take the old and blend it with the new, or you take the new and fit it with the old, you will end up destroying the very thing that you value. So one of the most important questions you got to ask yourself is, what exactly do I value? I'm going to close with this. Here's the point. Power and authority of Jesus Christ cannot blend, it cannot be reduced, it cannot coexist with a powerless gospel that lacks authority. Jesus did not come to be contained. Jesus came to proclaim good news to the poor, proclaim liberty for the captives, recovery of sight to the blind, liberate those who are oppressed, and proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. That's not about containment. The question is, what does belief in that Jesus look like? And Mark tells us belief looks like four men who ripped the roof up, because they had a firm, fixed posture of being persuaded that Jesus was worthy of placing the well-being of their friend into his hands. It looks like Matthew, where He heard Jesus. And he got up from where he was. He adjusted his posture. He placed his confidence, his trust, and reliance in Jesus Christ when Jesus called him to get up and follow. Belief looks like the first disciples who discovered that fasting has its place. But fasting was never about a religious rite. Fasting is about adjusting your posture to experience the presence and power of God, purging your body, your mind, and your soul to hear God with clarity. Christ in you, the hope of glory, is the mystery that God reveals in and through each one of us. Belief in Jesus Christ requires a shift in posture, where our behavior changes because we long to honor our Heavenly Father, not just because we know the rules. We want to make sure people behave right. And so we show them the rules, and we got them studying the rules, and their eyes are straight down, studying, studying, studying. And the Father says, if you look up, if you see you're living in my presence, don't you think you'll behave differently?
Come on.
I'm here. It's time to raise our eyes, to change our posture. Belief in Jesus requires fixing our gaze, our trust, our confidence and conviction that Jesus is the answer even when others cannot see the miracle that just took place. Belief in Jesus requires that we fix our posture, our confidence, trusting Jesus for the outcome because he has all power and authority. So my question is, what gospel do you live by? What do you believe? Jesus never lost his authority and power, and neither did his gospel. I think we've been sucking the life out of his gospel for generations.
Oh, yeah.
And it is time. It is time to let Jesus be the one that breathes life back into it.
Come on now. Come on.
My question is, do you know that Jesus or the contained Jesus? Do you know the one that can't be contained? Or are you trusting in one that you can contain? Just going to give you a chance. Here's the deal for me. I need you to know that I repent of the times that I have presented a gospel to you that is powerless and lacks authority. That's not the Jesus that I serve. I want his power, his authority, being what changes my life. So I'm going to just take a minute while they sing, play, whatever. If that's you, this is personal between you and Jesus. I don't think anybody needs to join you up here for prayer. You can handle this. But this morning, I need this.
In the crushing, in the pressing, you are making mine. In the sore light, now surrender. Yeah.
get the impression that God can't handle our whys. Every time Jesus was asked why, he answered. You can perhaps think of one of those times when Jesus was asked, by what authority do you do this? And he asked the question back and said, tell you what, you answer first, because they weren't really interested in the why. He can answer. He can handle your whys. He'll answer your whys. I'm convinced of that. But then you've got a decision to make when you hear the answer. Because he answers us throughout Scripture, right? We've got a decision to make. Do we believe it or don't? Do we believe that he can not only redeem our soul, he can heal our body?
Come on.
Do we believe that he has the authority to take the most contemptible people that we know and bring them into the kingdom? Like, do we really believe? Because all he did was apparently look and smile and say, hey, Matthew, hey, Levi, why don't you follow me a while? This past week, I got permission to get into to a jail and to a prison. I'll be going to the prison next. I made it to the jail. I got to the place where I was like, God, I'm not even sure you can get me in anymore. I joked with Pam. I said, maybe if I go do something that requires I be taken, then I'll finally get to see the people I want to see. Do we believe it or don't? Because if we really believe, it will change. You believe in fasting? Why? I believe in fasting, but it's got to be fasting that's different than just a rite. And I suppose it'd be wise that I not only ask God for forgiveness for the times that I've misrepresented his power and authority, but I need to ask you. I want to live in that. I want to live in that. It's not just a convenient message for today. I'm not just being dramatic. I'll leave the drama to Jesus.
I just have to say, it's simple. It's not easy, but it's simple. So just dip your toes in.
Now is the time for you to share your reflections on what's